Let me ask you a question. What do you think all these batteries and power supplies have in common? If you were thinking that they're all coming with one DC output voltage, then you're absolutely correct. With such a voltage, you can power almost every electronics device you will ever come across. But then there are also exceptions, like this waveform generator I built a while ago. After powering it with mains voltage, we can utilize the generator's interface to create an adjustable waveform on its output. Now, the remarkable property of this waveform is that in comparison to the DC voltages we had a look at before, whose voltage pretty much only played around in the positive area above the ground potential, this waveform can also enter the negative voltage area. This is possible because my waveform generator not only gets powered by a positive DC voltage that we're all familiar with, but also with a negative DC voltage. This makes this power supply a dual rail power supply. And believe it or not, but there are actually quite a few applications where such a positive and negative voltage can not only improve the circuit, but is sometimes even mandatory. Examples include audio amplifiers, different sensors, operational amplifiers, ADCs, DACs, LCDs, and much more. And that is why in this video I want to show you a few different ways to create a dual rail voltage, so that you will not be clueless when you're facing an application that requires one. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by Altium. If you were ever interested in turning such a perf board circuit into a proper PCB design, then the Altium Designer is for you. It comes with all the features you could ever need when it comes to designing a circuit or PCB. And since you can test it out for free, there's really nothing holding you back. So follow the link in the video description and give it a go. First off, before having a closer look at my a bit more complicated DIY dual rail power supply, let's rather start off simple with these boards that you can easily order from the internet. After hooking the inputs up to a voltage of 5 volts, we can measure an output voltage of plus 12 volts between V plus and ground, and minus 12 volts between ground and V minus. So yes, this is possibly the simplest way for you to get a dual rail power supply. But did you know that you can also easily turn a normal boost converter circuit that you probably have laying around somewhere into such a dual rail voltage circuit as well? To find out how, let's firstly remove all the components from the commercial dual voltage boards so that we can follow the copper traces and reverse engineer it to come up with this schematic. Now sadly, the main IC's label got removed. But after using my oscilloscope to find out that this pin is a transistor switch, which connects and disconnects our inductor to ground, and this pin is a feedback pin, which basically monitors a feedback voltage and lets the inductor get charged up more often when a bigger load gets attached, we can assume that the IC we're dealing with is a boost converter IC. And yes, I could have guessed that way sooner, since the circuit is converting a lower DC voltage into a higher one. But anyway, like already discussed, this part of the circuit is a classic boost converter. But then we got this additional part right here, that is a bit different and provides us with the negative voltage. It is called an inverting charge pump, and it works by firstly applying a high frequency square wave voltage to the first capacitor, that gets kindly provided by the boost converter. When the voltage is high, the capacitor charges up through the first diode. But when the voltage is low, aka we are at ground potential, then the first capacitor charges up the second capacitor through the other diodes. And since the second capacitor voltage is now inverted to the ground potential, we got a negative voltage. Super simple. So by choosing pretty common values for Schottky diodes and two capacitors, we can add this charge pump circuit to an already existing boost converter by soldering to the diode and ground point. As you can see, this way we can easily create an additional negative voltage, which this time is also adjustable. But one big problem of these circuit types still remains, and that is their maximum output current. According to the product page, the commercial version comes with a limit of 30 to 50 milliamps, which after testing with a potentiometer load seems to be about right. Now before the voltage breaks down, the big problem here is the switching noise, which comes with a peak-to-peak value of 1 volt when drawing around 50 milliamps. And let me tell you that sensitive audio or precision circuits will not enjoy 1 volt of noise. Now sadly, my DIY attempt performed even worse, but the reason for that is not the charge pump itself, but instead the boost converter. So I would recommend trying another one. But either way, the problem with such a charge pump will always be a bit of noise and a low current output. Which directly brings me to my waveform generator power supply, which can output 500 milliamps of current without a problem on both rails without featuring any noticeable noise. The magical component that makes this possible is a center tap transformer. You see, between the outer points of the two windings, we got a voltage potential of 30 volts RMS, which looks like this on the oscilloscope. After rectifying this voltage with a full bridge rectifier, we basically folded all the waves over to only one side. And since we are referencing all of this to the center tap, which is our ground potential, these voltage values basically get halved. That means on the plus side we got positive smaller waves, and on the negative side we got negative smaller waves. We can now smooth these waves out with capacitors and a linear voltage regulator, in order to ultimately create two beautiful 12-volt voltage rails. And in case you have no luck finding such a center tap transformer, then you can also use one with two identical output windings, which you only have to connect together like this, in order to turn it into a center tap transformer and thus create the desired positive and negative waves. Now the big disadvantages of this design is that AC mains voltage is kind of mandatory, and this whole voltage transformation is not as efficient as the charge pumps we had a look at before. But is there a simpler route, you might ask? Why not simply take two identical resistors combined together, to which we then add two big electrolytic capacitors to stabilize the voltage? And yes, without a load, this voltage divider setup basically splits up the supply voltage into two equal parts. And thus we can define the middle point as the virtual ground and the other two points as the positive half and the negative half of the supply voltage. But even while trying to draw symmetrical currents, meaning the same amount of current from the positive and negative sides, the virtual ground potential already started shifting around a lot due to small resistive differences inside my dual potentiometer. And when drawing current from only one side, then oh boy, the virtual ground potential shifts around super quickly. The reasons, of course, that with a bigger current on only one side, the voltage drops increase and decrease, which makes this resistive divider pretty much unusable. To improve this though, we can add an operational amplifier as a buffer between the voltage divider and the virtual ground. Like always, the op-amp will try to keep both of its inputs at the same voltage potential, and thus in this case it will do everything in its power so that its output stays at this voltage value too, thus stabilizing the virtual ground. And as you can see with the practical circuits, we can now draw more current while the dual rail voltages stay stable. But of course, the current limit is still tied to the output capabilities of the op-amp you're using. And if you need more, then I would recommend adding such a buff 634 buffer IC after the op-amp in order to increase the output current even more. There exists of course even more voltage rail splitter approaches, like with this TLE2426 IC, or this discrete transistor solution. But if you want to learn more about them, then I would recommend you to check out the links in the video description. And with that being said, you should now be familiar with a rather big assortment of dual rail power supplies and know how to use them when the time comes. As always, thanks for watching, and I hope you learned something new. If so, consider supporting me through Patreon. Don't forget to like, share, subscribe, and hit the notification bell. Stay creative, and I will see you next time!